Lord, we thank you for this worship service that you have brought us here. We thank you being the last combined service for the Latina Church, Maeza Church, and the youth, the children's, the students' church for this time. Lord, I pray that as we look into your word, inspire us.
Amen.
Help us to see the things that we can do to move us to where you want us to be in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Give us the grace to eliminate every form of distraction on our way to greatness in Jesus'
Amen.
Name. And Lord, we pray that your power will clear off every satanic obstacle that blocks our pathway in Jesus' name.
Amen.
We want to travel a free highway. We want to achieve in life. Open our eyes of understanding. Thank you, Lord, because we know you've answered. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray.
Amen.
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 Well, the message of today, Blueprint for Success and Greatness, is a message for everybody, a message for students, how to succeed, a message for adults, how to succeed, a message for all, how to move towards greatness and become relevant in this generation and become significant in your time. And not just live like a statistic that when you are gone, nobody even reckons about you. You lived, you died, and that's it. But there are people that live, but when they pass away, their memories remain forever because they leave an impact that you can't just go talk about it. And we've had people in history. How did those people get to that point? How can you talk about history of the black man? I never talk about Abraham Lincoln. I never talk about 1863 when there was the Emancipation Proclamation and slave trade was completely eradicated. How can you talk about the history of the black man and you don't talk about, you know, the Clapham, you know, sect and people like William Wilberforce who ended slavery in the UK? You know, these were people, they've been dead hundreds of years, but their memory, the impact, what they achieve, lives on. And we can be the same.
Amen.
And we will be the same.
Amen.
You know, tell yourself, I'm not just going to be a statistic in the world. I will be relevant.
Amen.
And that's important. And that's what the message is about today. Blueprint for success and greatness. Many people desire to succeed, but success is ever elusive. They never catch up with it. Some people are making painstaking efforts to succeed, but you know what? They have a past that is serving like a brake on their progress. You know what a brake does? If you want to move a car forward, you might be pressing the accelerator as much as you like. If the brake is on, will the car move forward?
No.
And some people are like that. They are pressing the accelerator. The throttle is there. The engine is roaring. But they have a past that is serving like a brake. They can't make progress. You will learn how to eliminate that.
Amen.
And the Lord himself will help you in Jesus' name.
Amen.
There are other people are denied the ticket to greatness because they refuse to change. My brethren, you know, there are things that we need to change in our lives. You may need to change your attitude. You may need to change your mentality. You may need to change your perception. You may need to change your work habits. You may need to change the way you relate with people. You may need to change a lot of things. And there are people that are refused the ticket to greatness because they refuse to change. There can be a change without progress, but there cannot be progress without change. It is not every change that results in progress, but progress is impossible without change. And there are people that want to succeed, they want to be great, they want to, you know, to succeed in life, but they don't want to change. It doesn't happen. Every form of progress demands a change. And it has been well said that those who refuse to change will always remain in chains. Those who refuse to change will always be fettered, bound, shackled in chains. we're going to talk about our past. And there's nobody that has a spotless past. The Bible says all have sinned and gone short of the glory of God. Nobody has a spotless past. Our past may be different, but they are all blotted in one way or the other. Everybody has a past. But it's not the past that matters. It's how you handle the past that matters. You can handle your past in a way that it is a hindering burden, slowing you down, weighing you down, not allowing you to make progress. Or you can consider your past like a valuable mine where you can go and quarry wisdom. You can learn lessons that can help you for effective living in the present. Those are two ways of treating the past. And the second way is better. Don't let your past weigh you down. No matter how bad the past has been, no matter how rotten the past has been, don't let it weigh you down. Your future is more important than your past. Where you are going is more important than where you are coming from. And if you are focused, you will get there.
Amen.
And the Lord himself will do it in Jesus' name.
Amen.
So, today as we look at the blueprint for success and greatness, we are going to look at some important pillars that support this thesis. And this is the focus of the message. If you want to succeed, if you want to be great, what are the things that you need to take into consideration? What are the things you need to do? What are the things you need to know? Number one, forgiveness is where it all starts. And that's the Lord's priority. You can never build a great life on a rotten foundation. It's impossible. The house eventually will collapse. Great edifices require strong and stable foundations. And the Bible says, if the foundations be destroyed, what can the righteous do? If the foundations are destroyed, if the foundations are faulty, there is not much anybody can do. And that's important. We must lay the foundation. And the foundation is a foundation of forgiveness. The Bible says, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. What will happen? Every other thing, what of those other things is success? What of those other things are greatness? Every other thing will be added unto you. So, it's important, seeking first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, so as to create a way for us to progress, is a forerunner of greatness. Forgiveness in Christ and forgiveness by the blood of Christ is the surest foundation for a successful life. You know what the Bible says? Look at Ephesians chapter 1, verse 7. The Bible says, we have forgiveness through his blood. It doesn't come any other way. It is through his blood. And that forgiveness comes as we repent. That forgiveness comes as we forsake our sins. That forgiveness comes as we come unto the Lord and tell him, oh God, I need, you know, a change in my life. I need to I need to go forward. In Ephesians chapter 1 verse 7, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. So the forgiveness of sins comes through the blood of Christ. In Ephesians chapter 2, the Bible says, and you are the quickened, verse 1, who were dead in trespasses and sins, wherein in time past, he's talking about our past. Some of us, that was our past. Some that may be here, this may still be your present, but make it your past today, that you come out of sin and come into his righteousness. Wherein in time past, you walk according to the course of this world, according to the priest of the power of the air, the spirit that now walks in the children of disobedience. It says, if you're a sinner, there is a spirit that controls you. It's a spirit, is the priest of the power of the air. It is the spirit that is still walking in the children of disobedience. In verse 3, among whom we all had our conversation, our lifestyles in time past, in the lust of the flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and the desires of the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. But God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sins and trespasses, hath quickened us together with Christ. By grace ye are saved. And has raised us up together and made us sit together where? In heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Can you see that? When you are in sin, you are in the valley. When you are in sin, you are wiped out. But when you become born again, then it takes you from the miry clay. He lifts you up from the valley. And he makes you to sit in the heavenly places with Christ. There is an exaltation that follows redemption. There is a kind of, you know, God lifting you up that follows redemption. The Bible says, before, we were not a people. But when you become born again, you become a people. Then God calls you. You become a chosen generation. You become a peculiar people. You become a holy nation. You become, you know, that's important. A royal priesthood. You become peculiar because there is an uplifting. That's why when people stay in sin and they are chasing after success, you just see that this person is just going to waste a lot of his life, because that's not the way to success. The Bible says promotion doesn't come from the east or the west. Where does it come from? It comes from God. And if you are in sin, how can you get that favor from God? No. And this is the best way, the first way, the foundation for success and greatness, forgiveness. And that's the Lord's priority. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. All these other things will be added unto you. Look at that, Ephesians chapter 2. Let me read to you from verse 11. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 11. It says, wherefore remember that ye being in time past Gentiles in the flesh, who are called on circumcision, by that which is called the circumcision in the flesh, made by hands, that at that time you were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope, and without God in the world. Can you see that? When we were sinners, look at our description. It says, number one, you were without Christ. Number two, you were a foreigner, you were an alien from the commonwealth of Israel. Number three, you are strangers to the covenant, from the covenants of promise. You have no hope without God in the world. But when you become born again, look at verse 13. But now, in Christ Jesus, ye who sometimes were far off are made nigh by the blood of Christ. Before, you were off the track. Before, you were far away. But now, God has brought you near. Because redemption in Christ has brought you near. Now, verse 14. It says, for he is our peace, who had made both one, and had broken down the middle wall of partition between us, having abolished in his flesh the enmity, even the law of commandments, contained in ordinances, but to make in himself of twain one new man, to make, so making peace, and that he might reconcile both unto God in one body by the cross, having slain the enmity thereby. He says in verse 17, and came and preached peace to you which were far off, and to them that were near. For through him we both have access by one Spirit unto the Father. You know what he was saying? When we were unbelievers, we didn't know God, but the Jews knew God. They had access to God. They had access into the inheritance of God. Then he now says, through the redemption, we are now like them. Both Jews and Gentiles, we now have access by one Spirit unto the Father. And the resources of heaven, they are there. My God shall supply all your need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus.
Amen.
But the question is, how do you have access unto the Father? How do you have access into those resources? By him, through him. We both have access. Look at it in verse 17. And came and preached peace to you which were afar off, and to them that were near. Verse 18. For through him, we both have access by one Spirit unto the Father. Now therefore, ye are no more strangers. You know where we started? When you were in sin, what the Bible says? You were a stranger. You were an alien. You had no recognition. But now that you are born again, verse 19, now therefore, ye are no more strangers and foreigners. But who are you? Or fellow citizens with the saints and of the household of God. Oh, my brethren, if you are here today and you are not born again, I pity you. It's time to be born again. It's the best that can happen to you. It's the best foundation in life that you can lay. He puts the resources of heaven at your disposal. He puts God at your disposal. It makes God to be able to support and help you. That's what happens. There are so many people chasing for success, chasing for greatness, chasing after money, and they never get it because where they ought to start, that's where they didn't start. And they're thinking, it's like somebody who is trying to erect a building like this, and it's too much in a hurry, and it will not lay foundation. We don't need any prophecy. We can tell him that after 1 month, that building is coming down. Say, what do you mean? A building that is beautiful like this, say yes, there's no foundation, it's coming down. The weight will crush everything. Lay the foundation, and this is the foundation, and it's the Lord's priority, the foundation of forgiveness. And the Lord will do it in your life in Jesus' name. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 1, I mean chapter 3. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, so that you can see that this is the proper foundation that we can lay. Foundation of forgiveness in Christ. And if you have not laid it as an adult, you need to lay. If you have not laid it as a student, you are going on holiday, lay that foundation. The foundation of repentance, the foundation of redemption, the foundation of forgiveness from sin. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 11. For other foundation can no man lay than that is laid, which is what? Is the cornerstone. That's the foundation. Is a rock upon which you can build, and when the winds of life blow, and when the waves billow upon your building, it will remain firm because it is built upon the rock. But the person that builds upon the sand is very foolish, because the winds of life will blow anyway. The storms will come, but great will be the fall of that house because it was built upon the sand. Other foundation can no man lay than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. So the foundation of repentance, of salvation, of forgiveness from sin, that's the Lord's priority, and is the first pillar in our blueprint for success and greatness. Forgiveness is God's priority if we ever hope to achieve greatness. And forgiveness has to be on three platforms. Somebody says, what do you mean? Number one is the most important. Receive forgiveness from God for your past sins, for your past misdeeds. Proverbs chapter 28 verse 13 says, he that covers his sins shall not prosper. But whoso confesseth and forsaketh them, what will happen? Will have mercy. Receive that mercy from God. Repent of your sins. Confess those sins. Abandon the sins. Forsake them, and God will have mercy. The Bible says, let the wicked forsake his ways. Let the unrighteous man forsake his thoughts. And let him return unto the Lord, for he will have mercy. And unto our God, for we are abundantly pardoned. If we will come unto him, we will receive that. Now number two, forgive those who have sinned against you. There are people that have hurt you. There are people that have sabotaged you. There are people that have spoken ill against you. There are people that have maltreated you. There are people that have blackmailed you. There are people that maybe there are some benefits you ought to get, but they went to go and spoil everything and just told lies against you, and eventually that door closed. You need to forgive them. Otherwise, you cannot move forward. You know, unforgiveness is like a chain. It will chain you, you know, to the past. You are not able to move forward. The person you are not forgiving, he doesn't know. He is living his life. He is free. But that unforgiveness will be eating deep within you, creating bitterness, you know, poisoning, you know, the source of life in you. You need to forgive. Let go. Amen.
Amen.
Let go. It doesn't matter what people have done. It's not the end of life. Let go. So you need to forgive other people. You know what? You remember the Lord's Prayer? Forgive us our sins. Finish it one for me. That's it. But there are some people that they say, God forgive me. But you don't want to forgive. You're wasting time. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who have trespassed against us. So you need to let go and forgive the people that have abused you, they've maltreated you, they've hurt you, they've spoken ill against you, they've, you know, done a lot of things, exploited you. Forgive. You know, many times we are praying and saying, oh God, I want you to give me a breakthrough. Do you know that your prayer is conditioned by forgiveness? Mark chapter 11. Mark chapter 11. Mark chapter 11 verse 24, it says, therefore I say unto you, whatsoever things you desire, when you pray, believe that you receive them, and what will happen? You know, that's where many believers stop. But prayer doesn't stop there. Look at verse 25. And when you stand praying, what should you do?
Forgive.
If you have ought against any, that your Father also, which is in heaven, may forgive you your trespasses. But if you do not forgive, neither will your Father, which is in heaven, forgive your trespasses. If you won't forgive men, you don't merit divine forgiveness. The Bible says, when you stand praying, forgive. You know, there are some people that are always crafty. And sometimes they don't read the Bible aright. You know, somebody that doesn't want to forgive, then he will see that and say, God, at least I'm not standing. What the Bible says is that when you stand praying, forgive. But I'm sitting down, my friend. What the Bible is saying is when you are praying, he's not talking about the posture. Amen?
Amen.
He's not talking about the posture. He said, when you want to pray, if you will not forgive, that prayer is useless. God will not hear it. So that's important. You need to, we want to pray for success. We want to pray for breakthrough. We want to pray for provision. We want to pray for God to make a way for us in the wilderness, to create rivers in the desert. The answer to that prayer is conditioned by your forgiving those who have trespassed against you. Amen.
Amen.
So number one, you need to receive forgiveness from God. That comes from heaven. Number two, you need to give forgiveness to people that have hurt you. You know, number three, look at yourself. Look at yourself. You need to forgive yourself. Do you know some of it? Why some people are not succeeding in life? And there are times you find a student will tell you, it's good to study. It's good to study. It's good to study. Don't watch TV. Sit down and study. But you wouldn't listen. Eventually, you fail. Your colleagues have moved forward, but you remain at the same point. But let me tell you today, you can still succeed.
Amen.
Now, you need to forgive yourself. The past is gone. There's nothing you can do about it. But you know, some students will say, well, if I had what they said to me, I would not be here. That's regret. That regret does not bring anything.
Yes.
Forgive yourself. It's gone, it's gone. Today is a new day.
Amen.
Start afresh.
Amen.
And you know, many of us are not succeeding because we have not forgiven ourselves. There are things we have done bad in time past, and we are regretting that if I did it the way I was told, I wouldn't have been in this mess. If maybe I listened to that advice, I wouldn't be in this shambles. If I did this one, I would not be. All those are regrets, and it can hold you back from making new moves. It can hold you back from making new achievement. It can hold you back from scaling new heights. You need to forgive yourself. Forgive yourself for your past mistakes. Forgive yourself for your foolish actions. Forgive yourself for refusal to heed good advice in the past. Forgive yourself for playing instead of working, playing instead of studying. That one is gone. If you have wasted 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, it's gone. But today is a new day.
Amen.
It's a brand new day. Feel it. Don't feel it with regret. Feel it with purpose. But if you don't forgive yourself, you find that you never move forward in life. And there are many people that are hindered because of that. They find it difficult to forgive themselves. And because of that, they are not liberated. They are bound. They are chained. They can't move forward. Forgive yourself. It's gone, it's gone. You can't reverse the past, but you can learn from the past. I pray the Lord will help us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
So remember, the first foundation, the first pillar is forgiveness. And that's the Lord's priority. Then number two, forgetting the limiting past. Oh, I want to talk about the past. Because many people don't understand. And especially people who have very terrible past. If they are going to move forward, they've got to forget that limiting past. If you have been a Rahab in Jericho, to have a brand new life, you need to forget that limiting past. Otherwise, it will weigh you down. Everybody knows your story. Everybody knows you all around. There is nothing, I mean, good to write up about you. Well, it's a past. Now that you are born again, forget that limiting past and move ahead. If we don't, this is what is pulling down many people. The past is weighing them down like a burden. The past is like a brake on their progress. They are putting on a lot of throttle. The accelerator, the engine is running, but the car cannot move forward because the past is a heavy brake on them. No progress. Forget the limiting past. Many people are not traveling fast towards life's achievement because their past is acting like a brake on their progress. Many are laden with bothersome emotions, anger, regret, guilt, resentment, and those are crippling emotions. Show me an angry person that can make progress. You'll never see. You know why? When you see an angry person, he can never make progress. If he makes progress, in moments of anger, he will destroy that progress. He buys a television screen. The day he's angry, he will flick something, it's coming down. He makes a new door. The day he's angry, bah! That money is gone. Show me an angry person and tell me this person is making progress. I will tell you that that progress cannot last. That anger will bring him down. That anger will destroy the fruit of his labor. That anger is going to come. These are crippling emotions. Show me a person that his life is always full of regret. He is anchored to the past. Have you ever seen somebody who is driving forward but is looking at the rear mirror? Have you ever seen a driver like that? You want to drive forward, but you are perpetually looking at the rear mirror. You need to look at the rear mirror once in a while to make sure that no car is coming. But that's your focus, rear mirror, and you are driving forward. After you have an accident, nobody. And regret is like that. Regret is like somebody that is perpetually looking at the rear mirror and is intending to go forward. You can never. It's a crippling emotion. Guilt. If you have sinned, confess the sin, get forgiveness from God, and move on. And let guilt get out of your life. You have committed abortion. Of course you will have guilt. It's normal because you have killed a life. You've committed immorality. Of course your mind will have guilt because you have sinned. But confess the fault, confess the sin, receive forgiveness from God, and move on. Don't go back into it and do away with guilt. Otherwise, guilt will cripple you. Resentment. Somebody has done something to you, and you are full of resentment. You want to have a revenge. I need to tell you that revenge and resentment, they are emotions that drain away energy. You feel empty after you have regret. You have no more energy to make any positive impact, to make any positive contribution. These are emotions, they are bothersome emotions. And these are the reasons why some people are not making progress in their life. You know, their lives are so full of bothersome emotions, anger, regret, guilt, resentment, and many others, malice. For some other people, they are weighed down by painful memories. Do you know why some women never get married? Painful memories. They've been guilted. One and another time and another time. Maybe a man says he's going to marry them, and eventually the man messes them up, abandons them, runs away with another woman. They meet another man, and the man does exactly the same thing. But do you know that if that woman is not going to abandon